I am Bonnie Barker with Bonnie Bay Crochet, and today I want to show you how to make the Celtic Cable Afghan. In this Afghan, you're going to learn many different styles of texturized crochet stitches, and you know, it's more of a sampler, and it's a great way to learn some of these stitches if you've never ever tried them before. Well, let me go ahead and show you what you're going to need. For this project, I'm going to be using Lion Brand Yarn's Touch of Alpaca. I'm going to be using 8 of these skeins, each with 415 yards. This is a worsted weight yarn, or an Aran weight, or a number 4. And if you don't have this yarn in your area, don't worry about it. Just feel free to use your favorite worsted weight or Aran weight yarn for this project. You will also need 2 crochet hooks. I'm recommending size J or 10 or 6.00 millimeter crochet hook. This is what you're going to use for most of this pattern. And for certain stitches, you're going to need a size K or 10.5 or 6.50 millimeter crochet hook. And as always, I'm recommending that you have a yarn needle and a pair of sharp scissors handy. One other quick thing, I'm going to be using color called cream to begin, and using the size J or 10 crochet hook, we are going to make our slip knot, and we're going to carefully chain 159 stitches. Now, as you do this, you're going to need to chain on the looser side. If you tend to crochet very tightly, I highly recommend that you use the larger hook in order to crochet the chain, then return to the size J hook after you're finished. So I'm going to go ahead and work my 159 chains. After completing your 159 chains, we're going to begin row 1 by working single crochets into the chain. I'm going to work into the side of just one of the V's of the chain, just like this, and we're just going to work a single crochet in each stitch all the way across. If you prefer working in the back bump of the chain, you can, but honestly, it's not going to make that much difference because we are going to work a perimeter round at the end around the remaining part of the chain. So go ahead and just work single crochets all the way across. At the end of this row, you should have 158 single crochets. This is what you should have at the end of row 1. Now let me show you something here. The end of mine is just a little bit curly. Don't let that worry you one bit. After the next 2 rows, a lot of that should practically disappear. Okay, now we're ready to do row number 2. And row number 2 is actually going to be row number 1 for the LFR, or the low front ridge rows. But this is number 2, row number 2 in the pattern. We're going to chain 1. We're going to skip the first stitch. And we're going to only work in the front loop of the stitch from the last row. So working in that front loop only, we're going to work a slip stitch. And we're going to do this in each stitch across, and by skipping that first stitch, this is not going to affect our stitch count because it's the next row, row 3, or the second row of the low front ridge, that's going to really maintain our stitch count. So go ahead and work the slip stitch. Let me show you. So you should have 1 loop back here still remaining, and we're going to work in that when we come back on row number 3. So go ahead and finish those slip stitches all the way across the row. I wanted to work the last 2 slip stitches of row 2 with you just so that there's no doubt as to where these stitches go. So I'm working a slip stitch there, and as you see, this is the last single crochet, and then you see the chain right there that we did not work in. So go ahead and make your last slip stitch in that last single crochet. Now we're going to turn, we're going to chain 1, and we're going to begin row 3, which happens to be the second row of the low front ridge.
Here's the last stitch that was worked on the other side. So now for this row, we're only going to work single crochets in the remaining loop. Okay, here is that remaining loop. Hopefully you can see that. It's a little tricky to get started, but once you see it, I think you'll catch on. So you can see the crochet stitch, the single crochet there, and you see that remaining loop. Just go up with your crochet hook, and then you see the next one right here. So we're just going to work single crochets all the way across. Our stitch count is still the same at 158 stitches. And I'm just going to work a few of these as I work across. And I want to show you the texture that this creates. This is what is being made, is this nice little low front ridge. And this, again, this will be the front side. We're working this single crochet. We're working in with the back side facing. So anyway, go ahead and finish that. I will show you the last stitch or so of this row too, just so there's no confusion. Now I'm going to work the last two stitches of row three with you. You can see the last two single crochets that are left, and we're just going to work a single crochet in that remaining loop. Okay. And let's go ahead and turn. And this again is with the front side facing, and you can see our low front ridge. Now for rows four and five, we're going to work rows one and two of the cable pattern. Okay, this is a little bit trickier of a stitch, but I think if you just watch a few times how it's done, it's pretty easy to learn. I'm going to chain one to start this row, single crochet in that first stitch. Now we're going to chain three, one, two, three. We're going to skip two stitches, one, two, and then we're going to single crochet in that next stitch. So far this is all that we have. Now we're going to turn our work so that we can work in those chains that we just made. We're going to work one single crochet in each chain, and I'm just working along the side of the chain. Don't even attempt to try to work in the back bump. There's no reason to make it that complicated. Okay, so we work one, two, three single crochets, one in each of those chains, and then a slip stitch in that first single crochet. And then we're going to turn our work again, and now working in the two stitches that were skipped, working through both loops, we're going to work a single crochet in each of those stitches, and we've made our first cable. Now we're going to do this again and again all the way across the row. So we're going to chain three, skip the next two stitches, make sure you don't count this because this stitch has already been used. So one, two, single crochet in that next stitch, turn to work in the chain, one, two, three single crochets, one in each of those chains, and then we're going to work a slip stitch in that single crochet. Now we can turn again, and we're going to pull this back a little bit, and then we see the two stitches that were skipped. We're going to work single crochets. Now obviously if we keep turning these stitches in the same direction again and again, as our work gets larger and the afghan grows, that can be a problem. So let me show you another way to turn. We're working the cable the same way, but the way that we get the yarn on the other side is going to differ here. Chain three, skip the next two stitches, single crochet in the next, and then we turn to work in the chains, and again one single crochet in each of those chains. Just work it along the side of that chain, slip stitch in the next stitch. Now this is where it's different. Now if we take our yarn and we bring it to the other side like this, and then we bring our hook around, that way we're not having to twist the blanket into a spiral, and then we're going to single crochet in those two stitches just skipped. Okay, I'm going to do this one more time and then I'm going to have you work across the row. If you need additional stitch support, you can always back up this video, or you can check out another video that I'm going to include in the video description below that is exclusively a video on the cable stitch. Okay, so one more time, chain three, skip the next two stitches, single crochet in the next stitch. I'm going to turn to work in those chains, one single crochet in each of the three chains, slip stitch in that next place. Now if we bring the yarn to the other side like this and twist our hook, and now we can work in those two single crochets that we skipped, working a single crochet in each. Let's take a look at these stitches. This is one of my favorite stitches. It just adds such lovely texture to any of the designs out there. Okay, so go ahead and finish that all the way across, and I will show you the end of the row. So after having worked this all the way across, I do have 52 of these cables in the row, and there should be one stitch left, and we're just going to work a single crochet in that stitch. Okay, now we're going to work row five, which is also row number two of the cable stitch. We're going to chain one. We're going to work a single crochet in that very first stitch. Now the next two stitches are worked behind the cable, but what we're going to do is we're going to work two single crochets in that first stitch, and then one, may need to pull back this cable a little bit, one single crochet in the next stitch. And then working behind the next cable, we work two single crochets in the next single crochet, and then this one right here, you might need to pull back this a little bit, work one single crochet. So in effect, we're going to be working three single crochets behind each cable stitch as we go across. So again, two single crochets, and then one in that next space. So go ahead, and we're going to finish it this way across, two single crochets, and then pull this cable back a little bit, and one stitch there. So go ahead and work that all the way across. I'll show you what it looks like from the other side. It really does help to give these cables a bit more definition. Okay, we have one more stitch to work at the end of row four. So we're just going to work in that very first single crochet. Let me show you. It's the very first single crochet of the row. So go ahead and work your last stitch there. And let's go ahead and take a look at what we have after four rows. Now notice that this is kind of curling under for me. So if that does it for you too, don't worry about that. We have another round to work once we complete this, and that's going to help with that quite a bit. Okay, so now for rows six and seven, it's just going to be a repeat of rows two and three, which is working that low front ridge. I'm going to go ahead and get you started. Remember, we're going to skip that first loop and working in the front loop only. We work those slip stitches just like that, and we work them all the way across only in the single crochets. And then after that, we're going to chain one turn, and then we work in the remaining loop of this stitch for the following row, and we work single crochets in that remaining loop. So go ahead and work rows six and seven, and that again is the low front ridge, the same that you did on rows two and three. This is what you should have after seven completed rows. Now we're ready to work the basket weave, and this is going to be rows 8 through 19. For rows 8 through 19, I'm going to refer you in the pattern to basket weave rows 1 through 6, of which you're going to work through two times. And we're going to do it this way. We're going to chain two, and for the first row, we're going to skip the first stitch. And in the next stitch, we're going to work what we call a front post double crochet. I'm just going to give a real quickie tutorial here. If you need additional support, please check my website or the video description below. I will have the list of stitch videos should you need extra support. Okay, we're going to work our hook around the stitch like so, pull up a loop, and then we complete the stitch as normal. We're going to do that in each of the first or the next three stitches. That would be 1, 2, and 3, just like that. Now we're going to work 3 back post double crochets, and we're going to come in the back side of the stitch. If you can see, we're going to come underneath like this, around, and then back out the back door. And then we complete the stitch again through the back, around, and through the back door again. So it's like wrapping the hook around the stitch to give it a belt. Okay, so we've done that 3 times. And now what we're going to do all the way across the rows, we're going to alternate by working 3 front post double crochets. And then we're going to follow that with 3 back post double crochets. 1, 2, and 3. Let's pause and take a look at that. So this is what this row should be looking like. And let me go ahead and pause a second and explain. If I am going too fast at any point in any of these videos, and this applies to all YouTube videos, there is a little gear-shaped icon down here. It's going to be on this side for the left-hand versions of these videos. If you click on that, it will bring up a speed menu, and you can select a slower speed should you wish. If you're watching from a cell phone, right up in the upper right hand corner, it'll be on this side for the left-handed videos. There are 3 vertical dots. You click on that and it will do the same thing. It will bring up the menu where you can select a slower speed, and if you're bored, you can select a faster speed and have fun with that one. Hope that serves you well. So go ahead and finish out row 1, and I will show you the end of this row. At the end of this row, you should have 1 stitch left. We're going to work a half double crochet, working through the top loops of that last stitch. Now, because we skipped the first stitch of this row, we are going to have 157 stitches instead of 158, but don't worry, we're going to make that stitch up once we complete the basket weave stitches. Okay, so let's go ahead and turn. Now, the next 2 rows of the basket weave are going to be worked the exact same way. So I'm going to show you how to start the second row of the basket weave with the chain 2. And again, we're skipping that first stitch, and we're going to work 3 front post double crochets. And then we're going to follow that with 3 back post double crochets, just like we did in the first row of the basket weave. But this should be much easier now since we're working in double crochet instead of in the tops of single crochets. So when you work this for the next 2 rows, make sure that when you work the front post double crochets that you're working over stitches that are pushed towards you in the row, just like this. And when you work the back post double crochets, that the stitches are protruding on the back side as you go across. So go ahead and finish rows 2 and 3 of the basket weave done in the same manner. And just to be sure that you know what to do, when you get to the end of the row, you're just going to work a half double crochet in that turning chain. Okay, so go ahead and finish those 2 rows. This is what your piece should look like after working those 3 rows of the basket weave. Now we're going to work rows 4 through 6, and they are going to be worked the same way. Now row 4, as we begin, is going to look a little different, and I'll go ahead and start that with you. Okay, so we're going to skip the first stitch. Now, instead of going with the flow or with the front post and then the back post, we're just going to reverse it for rows 4 through 6 of the basket weave. We're going to come in and we're going to work 3 back post double crochets, you're going to do just the opposite of what you see for row four. Okay, so three back post double crochets, and then we're going to follow that with three front post double crochets. Let's go ahead and get all the strands there. And that's what we're going to do across the row. So let me do this for you one more time. Okay, we're going to start with three back post double crochets. Again, this is the opposite of what you see, because you see the kind of front post or the posts that are facing you. You're going to work back post over those three, and then the ones that are behind, you're going to work three front post double crochets. And then you're going to work this all the way across the row. And at the end of the row, you're going to work a half double crochet in that chain two space, just like you did for the other rows. Now, let me show you something else. Now, when you're working for rows five and six, you're going to see this part facing you, and you're going to begin the row just like we did with three back post double crochets and then three front post double crochets. So when you work rows five and six, you're going to be going with what you see, but just be sure that you start with back post double crochets to start rows five and six, and you'll be fine. So go ahead and work the next three rows. Okay, this is what you should have after completing those six rows of basket weave. Now I'm going to start you on the next repeat. We're going to repeat rows one through six again to complete this section. I'll go ahead and start you off with the chain two. And since we're going back to working three front post double crochets and then three back post, we're going to be reversing the direction of the basket weave again. So we work three front post double crochets, and then we follow that with three back post double crochets. Okay, so I'll go ahead and stop there. So we are reversing it for this row, this repeat again of row one of the basket weave. And then we're going to repeat rows two and three again, and they are going to start the same way with three front post double crochets and then followed by three back post double crochets. And then after you do that, we're going to work the rows four, five, and six, which are going to start with three back post double crochets and then three front post double crochets, reversing the direction one more time. So if you need additional stitch support, you can go ahead and back it up to row number eight and take a look at that. But go ahead and complete the next six rows. This is what you should have at the end of row 19. Okay, now row number 20 is going to simply be to work single crochets across. We're going to chain one and we're going to single crochet in each stitch all the way across, and we are also going to work the turning chain. So I'll go ahead and work this row and the next row with you. So single crochet across and I'll show you the end of this row. And just to be especially clear, at the end of row 20, after working in all the stitches, we're going to work an extra single crochet in that turning chain, just like that. And okay, so after working that last stitch in the turning chain, that brings our stitch count back up to 158 stitches per row. That's very important. Now we're going to chain one and turn, and we're going to work an additional row of single crochets, but this time just work one single crochet in each stitch, but do not work in the turning chain. Okay, so that way we maintain our 158 stitches per row. So So after working row 21 all the way across with the single crochets, I just crochet in each single crochet. I do not work in that turning chain, therefore again retaining the 158 stitch count. Now I'm going to give you an assignment. We're going to chain one, and with the front side facing, this is what we're going to do. We're going to repeat rows 2 and 3, 4, 5, and 6 and 7 again, starting on this end. And let me say this another way. In the directions, it'll say to work rows 1 and 2 of the low front ridge. Remember, the low front ridge is where we work the slip stitch in the first, in the front row only, front loop only, and then we work the single crochet in the back loop, coming back the other way. And then we're going to work the 2 rows of the cable stitch, and then we're going to do another 2 rows working the low front ridge. So that is 6 rows. I'm going to have you work these 6 rows, and then we're going to work them again over here. If you need stitch support, you can certainly go back to row number 1. I'll put a little time mark across the bottom should you need that. And you might want to take a note of the time mark where you are right now in this video so that you can skip ahead once you get the refresher that you need. So just to rephrase that one more time, we're going to work, starting over here where we left off, we're going to work low front ridge rows 1 and 2, then the cable stitch rows 1 and 2, which is this cable stitch, and then the low front ridge rows 1 and 2 again. So you should have this on this end. So go ahead and complete those 6 rows, and then we'll continue on with a new stitch. Okay, this is what you should have after completing 27 rows. Okay, now we're ready to go on to the diamond pattern, and this is going to be rows 28 through 42, and the instructions say to, I guess we're going to work rows 2 through 8 of the diamond pattern, and then we're going to repeat rows 1 through 8 for this section. Now, the reason that we don't work rows 1 through 8 to begin is because you already have a row of single crochets left from the low front ridge. So that essentially counts as row 1 of that diamond pattern. So to do the diamond pattern, we're going to chain 1. We're just going to work single crochets in each stitch all the way across. Do not work in a turning chain at the end. Just 1 single crochet in each stitch all the way across. You should have 158 stitches per row. So go ahead. This is, again, this is row 2 of the diamond stitch because this one counts as row 1. Just single crochet. So go ahead and complete that. Okay, so after crocheting the diamond stitch, rows 2 and 3, remember the row from the low front ridge kind of acts as row 1, which is why we don't have to do row 1 for the first repeat of this stitch. After that, we're going to come to row number 4. So to start row number 4, we're going to chain 1. We're going to single crochet in the first 2 stitches. After that, we're going to get ready for a treble crochet, and this is going to be worked on 3 rows below, or on that row from the low front ridge, which again, like I said, I know I'm repeating myself, but just trying to be clear, this would serve as row 1 of the diamond stitch. So we have, and then we're going to count 6 stitches, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So stitch number 6 on 3 rows down, we're going to work a front post treble crochet right there. Okay, that's very important that you go down 3 rows and then you count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and then on that 6th stitch. Now behind, back up on the row that we're working on, we're going to skip that next stitch that is going to be right behind the treble. The treble stitch actually replaces that stitch for us. And then we're going to single crochet in the next 4 stitches. 1, 2, 3, 4. After we do that, we are going to work another treble crochet 3 rows down. and we're going to work it right next to where that last treble crochet was worked. We're going to work it right there. Okay, I'm going to pause a second and show you what this looks like. Okay, now we're going to skip. Actually, we're going to work another treble crochet. We're going to get ready for that, and we're going to skip 4 stitches down here, back on 3 rows below. 1, 2, 3, 4. And on the next stitch, we're going to work a treble crochet. Now, since we have 2 stitches that we've worked here, we're going to skip 2 stitches on the current row, on row 4. 1, 2. And then we're going to work 4 single crochets. 1, 2, 3, and 4. Let's pause and take a look at that. And notice how the angles of these trebles should be, you know, fairly consistent. Okay, they should be like 90 degree angles as you go about. Okay, now if they are not and they look much different than this, then perhaps you need to start row 4 again. Okay, so I'm going to do this a couple more times with you. Now I'm going to work a treble crochet right next to where the last one was worked, down there 3 rows below. And then I'm going to skip 4 stitches down here. 1, 2, 3, 4. And then work another treble crochet right there beside it. Skip 2 stitches. 1, 2 on the current row. And then work 4 single crochets. 1, 2, 3, and 4. And that is what you're going to continue all the way across the row. So go ahead and continue that, and I will show you the end of this row. At the end of row 4, after making the 2 treble crochets, we're going to skip 2 stitches. 1, 2. And then we're going to single crochet in the last 5 stitches. 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. Okay, so now for rows 5, 6, and 7, that's 3 rows, we are going to work them in just straight single crochet with a chain 1. And a single crochet in each stitch across. So go ahead and complete rows 5, 6, and 7, and then I will show you row 8. Okay, this is what we should have. After you finish those 3 rows of single crochet, that would be rows 5, 6, and 7. Now we're going to work row 8, which is going to be another row with the lattice work with those treble crochets. Okay, so we're going to start with a chain 1, and we're going to single crochet in the first 4 stitches. That's 1, 2, 3, and 4. Okay, after we do that, we're going to work a treble crochet. Now, this is going to be easy because we're going to go down 3 rows just like we did before. 1, 2, 3, and we're going to work that single crochet, which is right on top of that other post. See the other post here? And we're going to work it right over or around that single crochet work, a front post treble. And then we're going to skip 4 stitches, 1, 2, 3, 4, just like we did before. But it's easier visually because we have something to go by now. So on top of this stitch, you see this single crochet right there. And that's where we put the next treble crochet. Working back on row 8, we skip 2, 1, 2, and then just like in the other, on row 4, we're going to single crochet in 4 stitches. That's 1, 2, 3, and 4. And I'll go ahead and work a couple more with you. Now we're going to treble crochet on top, right next to this stitch, and it's on top of the stitch right down there on row 4. Okay. skip 4 stitches, 1, 2, 3, 4. These are all, again, the third row below. And then the next single crochet, which is above this stitch, which is right here, we're going to work a treble crochet around that. Back to row 8, skip 2 stitches here, and single crochet in the next 4 stitches. Okay, so you see how that encloses making diamonds. So that's what we're going to be working. Go ahead and work that all the way across the row, and I'll show you how the row ends. At the end of row 8, I have worked the treble crochet, and since I only worked one, I skipped 1 stitch, and then I single crochet in the remaining 3 stitches. And that's the way row 8 ends. Now I'm going to give you a small assignment. We're going to repeat rows 1 through 8 one more time. Again, rows 1, 2, and 3 are just single crochet rows. And then row 4 is going to be worked this way. And then 5, 6, 7 are just single crochet rows. And then row 8 is worked this way. If you need stitch support, I'll go ahead and put a time mark down across the bottom of the video so that you can go back and rewatch. I guess the video will start with row 2 because row 1 is again part of the low front ridge here, but you know that you're going to need to do 3 rows of single crochet before you work row number 4. So go ahead and work those next 8 rows, and then I will show you what to do after that. This is what your diamond pattern should look like after completing rows 28 through 42. Okay, now for row number 43, we are going to just simply work a row of single crochet. So we're going to need to turn, chain 1, and just single crochet in each stitch of cross. And you should still have a total of 158 stitches. Okay, now we're ready to go on to rows 44 and 45, which is again the low front ridge. I'll just start you on this. This is where you chain 1 and you work that slip stitch in the front loop only all the way across. And then as you chain 1 and turn and come back the other direction, we are going to work in the remaining loop. As you come back the next direction, you're going to work in the remaining loop, working single crochets in each stitch across. So go ahead and work those, that low front ridge, rows 44 and 45. Now we're ready to work rows 46 through 49, which are to work the knurl pattern, rows 1 through 4. This stitch is also known as the reverse single crochet, or some of you may know it as the crab stitch. It is pretty much the same. Okay, so we're going to start with a chain 1, and row 1 is just to simply work 1 single crochet in each stitch all the way across the row. So go ahead and work that. Okay, after working row 1 all the way across, it's time to start row 2. But to begin row 2, we do not turn our work. This is where the fun begins. This stitch is going to be worked from this side to this side, going across. It's the opposite direction that we're used to. So let me go ahead and show you how I do this. This is a slower stitch. Do take your time with it. But by all means, do not overthink this stitch. Okay, we're going to chain 1 and we're going to skip the first stitch. Now we're going to work from this direction to this direction, and we're going to work only in the front loop. And we're going to reserve that back loop for coming back the normal direction. And we're going to work single crochets in that row. That would be row 3. But right now we're doing row 2, which is the actual knurl. Okay, we're going to skip that stitch. Now I'm going to bring my hook into the front loop of that second stitch. And don't worry about the stitch count. This does not affect the stitch count. We pull up a loop, just like we're doing a single crochet, yarn over, and pull through 2. And it's a little awkward going the opposite direction, but we put our hook in there, pull up a loop, yarn over, pull through 2. So let's work that a couple more times, coming up in that front strand. I'm going to try to hold this so that you can see coming just right up here. Pull up a loop, yarn over, and pull through two. Notice I'm not making any attempt to control where the strands lie, but if you must know, as I bring this up, this is the strand that was brought up. This is the strand that was already on the loop. Yarn over and just pull through two. I'm actually holding my thumb on the other one. You can see that. I'm trying to go very slow because I know the yarn does get in the way. So we're going to work this all the way across until we get to the last stitch. We're going to do something just a little bit different once we get to that last stitch. After working this knurl stitch or reverse single crochet all the way across in the front loop, we have one loop left and we're going to work a reverse slip stitch. And this is the way we do this. Put the hook up into that one loop only, catch the loop. It's going to go through both loops just like that. We didn't wrap it. Go ahead and give it a little bit of a tug so that it tucks securely in there at the end of the row. Now for row three, we're going to chain one, and working in the remaining loop, we are going to work a slip stitch all the way across. So it should be easy to see that remaining loop. Just let the hook slip into place and work those single crochets. I will meet you at the end of this row. Okay, I've worked the single crochet all the way across, but I just wanted to show you that there is one more single crochet right here. It'd be really easy to miss that stitch. Go ahead and make sure that you work that stitch and that these stitches are, you know, flush with the edge just like that. So that ends row number three of that four stitch pattern. And so for the fourth row number four of the knurl stitch, go ahead and work a row of single crochets working through both loops normally. So go ahead and finish that row. Now for rows 50 and 51, we're going to once again work the low front ridge just like we've done a couple of times already. I'll just start the row for you. You're going to chain one, skip the first stitch, and working only in the front loop, we're going to work those slip stitches all the way across the row. And then at the end of the row, we're going to chain one turn. And then coming back the other direction, we're going to work single crochets in the remaining loops here. So go ahead and finish those two rows of the low front ridge. And let's take a look at what you should have after completing the low front ridge rows. Add the knurl stitch. Okay, it's coming along quite nicely. Okay, now we're ready to go on to the popcorn stitch. And before we do that, there's something very important you really need to do. If you don't do this, your stitches are going to suffer. We're going to change our size J hook for a slightly larger size K hook. This is size 10.5 or 6.00 millimeters circumference around the size of the hook. Okay, and the reason we do that is because these stitches tend to pull in a bit, so you need to go up a size larger in the hook. Okay, so to do this, we're going to chain one. This is working the popcorn pattern starting with row one. Okay, so we chain one. We're going to single crochet in that first stitch. After we single crochet in that first stitch, we're going to chain one. We're going to skip the next stitch. And then we're going to work a popcorn in the next stitch. Let me move this fabric out of the way for you. And the way, there we go. And the way we work the popcorn stitch is by working four single crochets in the space. So in the same space, once we do that, we pull up a loop. We insert our hook in the first single crochet of that popcorn grouping and we grab the loop and then we pull it through. And that should pull this tight. Go ahead and give it a chain. Don't chain too tightly because we are going to have to work in that chain in the next row. Now we're going to skip the next stitch, single crochet in the next stitch. And we're going to do it again. Chain one. Skip the next stitch, work a popcorn in the next stitch, which is 4 single crochets worked all in that same stitch. Pull up a loop, insert your hook into that first stitch of the grouping, grab that loop and go ahead and pull it through and give it a chain. And again, make sure that this is large enough to work in, but don't leave it too slack that the popcorn doesn't pop. Okay, no pun intended there. Skip this stitch, single crochet in the next stitch, and you have your repeat across. Chain one, skip the next stitch, popcorn, which is 4 single crochets. In that next stitch, pull up a loop, put the hook in, grab that loop, pull it through, and give it a chain. Skip the next stitch, single crochet in the next. So this is what you should have, and go ahead and work that across, and I will show you how the row ends. So after working this repeat all the way across, you should have 1 stitch left. We're just going to single crochet in that last stitch. You should have a total of 39 popcorns in this row. Now we're ready to start row 2 of the popcorn stitch. We're going to chain 1. We're going to single crochet in that very first stitch. And this is what we're going to do all the way across. We're going to chain 1, skip the next stitch, and our next single crochet should be in the top of that popcorn. Chain 1, and then we're going to single crochet in the chain 1 space right there. Chain 1, skip the next single crochet, and single crochet in the top of that popcorn. A lot of times people have trouble with losing stitches on this particular row. So this is a simple row, but yet a very important row. So you're basically just working single crochet, chain 1 single crochets, and we're skipping either the single crochet here, or which is over here. We're really not skipping anything, but there is kind of a bulk caused by that popcorn. And do be sure that you work, like, for example, going to chain 1. We're going to work that next single crochet in the chain 1 space. So chain 1 space. Then we chain 1, skip the next single crochet, work in the top of that popcorn stitch. Chain 1, skipping the bulk of that popcorn, or just go right to that chain 1 space. Okay, so go ahead and work that all the way across the row. At the end of row 2, you should have 1 stitch left. Just work a single crochet in that stitch. And one other hint, you want to be careful to be sure that you are putting a chain 1 in between each of these single crochets across, because if you don't, that can also throw your stitch count off going forward. Okay, let's go ahead and turn, and we're going to start working row number 3 of the popcorn stitch. We're going to chain 1, single crochet in that first stitch, then we're going to chain 1, skip the next single crochet. Single crochet in that first chain 1 space. And then we're going to chain 1, skip the next single crochet in the next chain 1 space. We're going to work a popcorn stitch. And you're going to notice that these are going to alternate from row 1 of the popcorn. Okay, so we work those 4 single crochets, stick the hook in that first stitch, pull the loop through, and give it a chain. Make sure it's secure but not so tight that you can't crochet into it. Skip the next stitch, single crochet in the next chain 1 space. Chain 1. After that chain 1, we're going to work a popcorn, which is those 4 single crochets in that next chain 1 space. Put the hook in that first stitch again, pull up the loop, pull through, and give it a chain. So that is the repeat all the way across. I'll do it one more time for you. Skip the next stitch, single crochet in that next chain 1 space. Chain 1, skip the next single crochet, work a popcorn in this next chain 1 space. There's 4 single crochets. Put your hook in the first stitch again, pull that loop through and give it a chain. So make sure that your stitches are alternating like this as you go across. And remember, this is just a chain one space here. This is not a popcorn. So we come to the end of row three. We're going to skip the next stitch. We will chain one, single crochet in that last chain one space, and then single crochet in the last single crochet. You should have a total of 38 popcorns, which is just one less than this row all the way across. So again, row one of the popcorn stitches, you should have 39 popcorns. For row three, you should have 38. Okay, so let's go ahead and turn. To begin row four, it is the repeat of row two of the popcorn stitch. We chain one and we single crochet in that very first stitch. Then we work a chain one, skip the next stitch, and then we single crochet in that next chain one space. Chain one, skip the next stitch. We're going to, let's get all the threads there of that yarn. Then we're going to single crochet in the top of the popcorn stitch. I'll do this for you again. Chain one, and then we're going to skip what's really the bulk. We're not really skipping a stitch here. We're just moving past the popcorn and single crochet in that next chain one space. Chain one, skip the next single crochet in the top of that next popcorn. Chain one, and single crochet in the next chain one space, and just on and on all the way across the row. And let's talk through the end of the row, because you've already seen that one time, but let's just review. Okay, we're going to be single crocheting in the top of this popcorn stitch. Chain one, single crochet in the chain one space here. Chain one, single crochet in the chain one space here, and then single crochet in the last stitch of the row, and that will end row four. So after you complete rows one through four, so rows one, two, three, and four, we're going to repeat rows one through four one more time, and then you're going to repeat row one again. So when we finish this popcorn section, you're going to have a total of 9 rows. So go ahead and complete the rest of those. That would be row four plus rows 5, 6, 7, 8, and 9. Now this is what your completed popcorn section should look like. Okay, now we're going to do something very important. We're going to turn to work the row that will discontinue this stitch. But the most important thing you need to do is you need to change back to your smaller or size J or 10 crochet hook. This is very, very, very important. If you don't do this, then this next row is going to be all out of sorts for you, and I don't want that to happen. I don't want you to have to do any more ripping out than is entirely necessary. Okay, so for this row, we're going to chain one. We're going to single crochet in that first stitch, the first single crochet. And what we're going to do across is we're going to skip the next stitch, and we're going to work two single crochets in each chain one space across. So there's two in the top of the popcorn stitch. And then after that, there are going to be two worked in the next chain one space, which is in between the popcorn and that single crochet. We're going to skip this single crochet. Again, just working in the chain one spaces, two at the top of the next popcorn stitch, and then two in that next chain one stitch, which is in between the popcorns. We're skipping this stitch, two single crochets in the top of the popcorn. So basically, two single crochets in each chain two space all the way across. So go ahead and do that, and I will show you how to end this row. Okay, I've worked this single crochet, two single crochets in each chain one space all the way across. This should have one stitch left. And let's go ahead and work a single crochet in that last stitch. And this is a really good time to go ahead and verify. You should have 158 single crochets across. Make sure that you work them with your smaller size hook. Again, size J hook. I can't emphasize that enough. Why? Because I have made that mistake more times than I can count. So I just want to keep you from making that mistake. So go ahead and double check to make sure that you have 158 stitches. And then we're going to go forward, because if you don't have 158 at this point, you're going to have problems with the stitches that we're going to do after this. Okay, so let's go ahead and turn. And the next thing that we're going to do is the two rows of the low front ridge. And you've already done that many times before. That's these rows here. So I'll get you started on this. Then I'm going to go ahead and do these two rows. I'm going to skip that first stitch. And remember, this is working only in the front loop. And we're going to do those slip stitches in that front loop all the way across. And then at the end of this row, we're going to turn, chain one, and then we are going to work a single crochet in the remaining loop of those single crochets. Okay, so go ahead and work two rows of the low front ridge. And let me give you the row numbers on this. This is four rows 62 and 63 if you're following along with me in the written pattern. Okay, after finishing the two rows of the low front ridge, we're ready to move on. And now we're going to work rows 64 and 65. This is called the arrow stitch. We're going to chain two to begin. And we're going to double crochet in the very first stitch. Now we're going to begin the arrow stitch. We are going to prepare for a treble crochet. We're going to skip three stitches, one, two, three, and we're going to work that treble crochet in that next stitch, just like that, working through the top loops. Now working behind this stitch, we're going to come in and we're going to work double crochets in the three stitches that we just skipped. One, two, and three. All right, and we're going to do that all the way across the row. So we're going to do that again. We're going to get ready for that treble crochet and skip three stitches. One, two, three. Treble crochet in that fourth stitch. And working behind that treble, we're going to double crochet in each of those skipped stitches. One, two, and three. Okay, and that's what we're going to do all the way across the row. I get a lot of questions, people asking me about this hole formed with the treble crochet and how to make it smaller. I wouldn't worry about that. That's actually part of the beauty of the stitch. And so just, you know, go with it. I think it really does add some texture to the stitch, and I don't think it's anything to worry about. Okay, I'll do this for you one more time. Skip three stitches, treble crochet in the next, and then working behind that treble crochet. Make sure you're working behind so that that treble is on the top, you know, on the surface. And we double crochet in those three stitches that we just skipped. All right, so go ahead and work that across, and I'll show you how the row ends. After working these all the way across, you should have a total of 39 arrows begun. And then we work a double crochet in that last stitch. Okay, now we're going to turn to work row two of the arrow, or this is also row 63 in the throw. We're going to chain two, double crochet in that first stitch. And now we're going to do something similar to what we did in row one of the arrow. We're going to skip three, one, two, three stitches, and we're going to treble. And when you treble, make sure that you are working in that same treble stitch from the previous row. Now this is where this row is different. Working in front of that treble, we're going to double crochet in each of the three stitches that we skipped. just like that. I'll do it for you one more time so that you understand. Okay, we skip the next three stitches. 1, 2, 3. Treble crochet. And again, that's going to be in the treble crochet from the previous row. Working in front of this treble stitch, we're going to double crochet in the three stitches that we skipped. This is a very easy cable, but it's still one of my favorites. I just love the texture, love the way it looks when you complete it. This is from the back side, and when you turn to look at the front side, you should have an arrow. And as you see, there are these characteristic holes in this pattern, but that is by design. It's not a problem at all. Okay, so go ahead and finish out that row, and I'll show you how this row ends. At the end of row 2 of the arrow stitch, we're just going to work a double crochet in that last stitch. And let's go ahead and turn. And so this is what the arrow stitch should look like, all the way across there. Now we have a small assignment I'm going to give you because they are easy rows. For rows 66 and 67, we're just going to single crochet in each stitch across. I'll go ahead and start you on that. This is just single crochet in each stitch all the way across the row. Then we're going to chain one and turn, and then single crochet all the way across, coming back the other direction. After we do that, for rows 68 and 69, we are going to again work the low front ridge pattern, rows 1 and 2. And again, that's where you work in the slip stitch, working in the front loop, and then coming back, you work the single crochet in the remaining loop. So go ahead and finish rows 66 and 67 again, which are the two rows of single crochet, and then rows 68 and 69, which is the low front ridge, rows 1 and 2. This is what you should have after completing those four rows. I'll give you a view of the arrow section and those two rows of single crochet, and then the row of the low front ridge, rows 1 and 2. Now we're ready to start rows 70 through 80. And this is working the Celtic weave pattern, which is one of my favorite stitches in the whole wide world. Okay, we're going to chain two and double crochet in that first stitch. Now this is where the Celtic weave begins. Okay, this is made up of all treble crochets, front post trebles. We're going to skip the next two stitches, and then the next two, we're going to do front post trebles. Notice that I am wrapping around the stitch, not going in through the top loops. Okay, one, and then one in the next stitch, or around the next stitch. Now this is what we're going to do all the way across, working in front of those last two stitches. We're going to front post treble in those two stitches that we skipped. First the one furthest away, and then the next one, just in order. And so we make these little crosses with two front post trebles, and then two front post trebles worked in front. So we're going to do that across, skip the next two stitches, 1, 2, and then front post treble in the next two stitches, 1 and 2. Now working in front of the two stitches that were just worked, we're going to work front post trebles in the two skipped stitches, 1 and 2. So now we have two sets of crosses. Let's do that. I'm going to do that for you one more time as we go across the row. Skip the next two, 1, 2, and then front post treble in the next two stitches. Working in front of the last two stitches, front post treble in the two stitches that we skipped. So go ahead and work that all the way across the row. If you need additional stitch support, you want to watch a longer video on this, check in the video description below in the stitch list, and I should have another video for you to watch on the Celtic weave. At the end of row one of the Celtic weave, go ahead and work a double crochet in that last stitch. Okay, and let me give you a stitch count. Okay, so at the end of row one, you should have a total of 39 of these four stitch crosses with the front post treble crochets. Okay, plus a double crochet at the beginning and at the end of the row. Now we're going to turn and we're going to work row two of the Celtic weave. Okay, there we go. We're going to chain two and we're going to double crochet in that double crochet, just like that. And by doing this, we're going to maintain a continuous stitch count throughout. Now, we don't begin by crossing immediately. When we start the Celtic weave, we are going to work two back post treble crochets to start. And I'll go ahead and get through all the loops. There we go. And two. Okay, and the reason that we're going to do this, I'll show you more clearly in a minute, but just trust me on this. You're going to end and begin with two back post treble crochets. Okay, now we start skipping. We're going to skip the next two stitches, and they're leaning this direction. And we're going to back post treble over these two that are going to be leaning this, let me see if I can show you, this direction. Okay. I don't want to say right or left because some of you are going to be watching the left-handed version and some of the right-handed, and whatever I say is going to be the opposite. So I'll just point in the direction that the stitches should be leaning. Okay, now after this, we are going to work in, as seen from the front side, we are going to work back post treble crochets over these two stitches, but we want to make sure that they're behind these two. Okay, so we're going to bring our hook all the way back. And we're going to hook this stitch with that back post treble. And again, use the nerve endings in your tall man and thumbkin here to help guide. That's what I'm doing here. I have a hold of that stitch and I'm coming all the way around. You see, I'm not weaving in between or anything like that. Go all the way on the outside here. I'll do a couple of these and I'll show you what it looks like. And then we work that back post treble crochet. Okay, grabbing some more yarn here. Now I'm going to do this again. And all the way across, we're going to skip the next two stitches. And these two that are leaning towards you on the outside, we're going to work a back post treble on those two stitches. And again, working behind these, or in front of these is the way the pattern is written, working in front of these stitches as seen from the front side. Again, come around the back and we're going to grab this stitch first for that back post treble crochet. This used to seem very difficult, but I have some other stitches that can be a little more challenging than this one. It's not really that hard. It's just a matter of knowing where to put your hook in this stitch. Okay, so this is still the back side. Let me show you the front side. See how this looks. Now the front side should look like this. Now if yours doesn't look like this, then you need to pull it out and try again. And it's okay to make mistakes with these kinds of stitches. That's how we all learn. And actually, this is how this Celtic weave stitch was developed. My daughter encouraged me one day to just do something different that I haven't done before. And in a nutshell, the Celtic weave stitch was born that's done in this particular manner with this technique. If there are any doubters out there, try to find out where it was first published. You won't find it before 2010 because I published it in the Erin Afghan's leaflet. Many years ago, gosh, it's been over 10 years now. Okay, so I'm doing another one for you. I worked those two back post trebles, and then again, coming in behind And then I'm going to grab one of those stitches that I skipped and then come around for the other one. Okay, I'm going to work this all the way across the row, and then I'll show you the ending of the row. I've just worked the second row of the Celtic weave all the way across, and I have two post stitches left here and a double crochet. And so what we're going to do is we're not skipping any stitches from where the last stitches were worked. We're just going to back post treble crochet in those remaining post stitches. And then we're going to work a double crochet in the top of that double crochet. Okay, just as a review, remember we started this row, go ahead and find it, that we started this row with the two back post treble crochets, and then we end with two back post treble crochets. That's the way each row two will end. Okay, so now let's go ahead and turn and take a look at what we have here. Okay, so that's what you should have after two rows of the Celtic weave. Now, the next eight rows are going to be repeating rows one and two. So we're going to repeat rows one and two four more times, and then we're going to repeat row one again. At the end of this section of the Celtic weave, you should have a total of 11 rows of the Celtic weave. Now, a good way to count the rows, you can count by looking at the end stitches. You can count the rows that way, or you can count the crosses. Like this will be one row, two rows, and then you'll have additional ones as you go up. So go ahead and work rows one and two of the Celtic weave four more times, and then work row one additional time. And then I'll show you the row to discontinue the Celtic weave. After completing the Celtic weave rows, this is what the section should look like. Now, I did go through this kind of quickly, I understand. So if you feel like you need additional instruction on this particular stitch, which can, granted, be a little bit challenging, please check the video description below, and I will have a link there for you so that you can get additional instructions on this particular stitch. Now, for the next row, we're going to work the row that will discontinue the Celtic weave, and this is quite simply a row of back post double crochets, but I'll go ahead and start this with you. We're going to chain two, go ahead and double crochet in that first double crochet, and then all the way across, we're just going to work back post double crochets. We're not crossing anything. This is not working the Celtic weave stitch. It's just working back post double crochets all the way across. So go ahead and do that. And when you get to the end of this row, we're going to work a double crochet, but I'll show that to you when I get to the end of the row. After working that back post double crochet all the way across, you should have one stitch left, that double crochet, and go ahead and work a double crochet in that. And let me go ahead and show you what this looks like. Now, I should have mentioned this before, but I'll mention it now. Sometimes you may experience a little bit of curling, like you see the edge curling here. That may have happened to you earlier on in this. That is perfectly normal. It's okay. And as if you've gone on ahead, you'll notice that as you add the additional rows, the curl kind of goes away. We may have a little tiny bit of a curve to this now, but we're a long way from finishing this. So actually just past halfway. So the additional rows are going to definitely take that curl out. Okay, let me go ahead and show you what I have so far. Okay, I just finished working the Celtic weave section over here. Now, the rest of this pattern is very much exactly symmetrical to what we've already done. So in other words, what we're going to do now is we're going to work the rows here, which would be the low front ridge, followed by the arrow stitch,
and then the low front ridge, the popcorn, low front ridge, etc., working this direction. And since I've already taught you all of these stitches one time, what I'm going to do is I'm going to list the stitches in order in the video description below, and I will put a time mark as to where you need to go to do that particular stitch. Now, many of you, if you followed me for a while and you know these stitches already, you can just glance going the other direction and know what stitch you need to do next. Some of you are going to need some extra stitch support, and that's why I'm doing this. So go ahead and look at the list in the video description, and I'll have that time mark ready for you. For example, if you want to do the low front ridge, which you should know very well by now since we've worked it a bunch of times, but I will have that time mark. You can go back to that part in the video and watch that. For the arrow, the same thing. Just go look for the time mark in the video, and that'll take you right to what you need to look at in order to get there. So what I want you to do is go all the way through until you finish the cable stitch and the low front ridge, rows 1 and 2. And then I'll come back and show you what we need to do next, because we still have quite a bit of finishing touches to complete after that. So go ahead and work the other half, and then I'll show you what I have. Okay, I have finished through row 149. And just to reiterate what I had said earlier, once you finish the Celtic weave portion, which is right here, then we are going to make everything on this side symmetrical with what happened here. So we have the arrow stitches with the trimmed with the low front ridge, and that's over here, and etc. The popcorn, and then the popcorn. And if you look at my edge, you can see that it is not perfectly straight. And I wanted you to see that so that you don't get concerned if yours is not perfectly straight, because what we're going to do from this point on is going to fix this. We're going to work a perimeter around, which is going to go across or around the entire blanket. We are going to be working a certain number of single crochets along the ends of the rows, and we're going to be working slip stitches along the edge of both of these. So, and then after we do that, we're going to complete this by working woven stitch right across the bottom and across the top of our throw. So let's go ahead and finish that. Now we're going to work our perimeter round, and as we begin, you should have the front side of your work facing you. We're going to chain one, and working in each stitch and going through both loops, just like we would a normal stitch, we're going to work slip stitches in each stitch until we get to the next corner. I've worked the slip stitch all the way across, and one thing you should have noticed is that there is a tendency of this edge to curl. But when you work the slip stitch, it does take some of that tendency out, so it makes it a little straighter. If it's still tending to curl in a way that you don't like, you can always just wet block this project at the end to help that to settle out, and that would be fine. Okay. So now we're going to chain one, and we're going to work across the row ends. And the instructions say to work 124 single crochet evenly across the edges. And we're going to do that simply by working single crochets in the row ends. And we're going to do this as evenly as possible. Now, I know it can be really frustrating if you're working across and let's say you're just a few stitches off. And people are going to ask me, is it important that I have exactly 124? Well, it actually kind of is. So let me give you a strategy that will help you with this. I've gone ahead and using stitch markers, I have put a stitch marker in the middle. Let me show you the section here. In the middle of the Celtic weave, which is the center of the Afghan. And I also put one in the center of the edge and the middle. So basically 1/4 of the way to the across the side. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to do a little bit of math here. So from the beginning where I started
the first single crochet along the row edge. To this point, I should have, which is 1/4 of the way across, I should have 31 stitches. And then between this stitch marker and the stitch marker marking the center, another 31. And from the edge until the very center, which again, I estimated by, you know, visually estimating here, I should have 62 stitches. And that way, if I just continue in increments of 31, it's a lot more forgiving to have to pull out a few stitches in order to correct the number 31 than 124. So I hope that kind of helps you have a strategy so that you can finish these 124 stitches across. These are single crochets. And let me just show you quickly, once you finish that, we're going to chain one and we're going to turn to work across the chain, the foundation chain. And all we're going to do is we're going to work putting our hook in the remaining two loops of that chain. We're going to work slip stitches, okay? Single crochets across the bottoms and the bottom and top of the throw. But along the edge, we're using slip stitch. So slip stitch across all those, chain one. And then again, when you come to the row ends, we're just going to work 124 stitches, just like I explained, evenly across. And then we're going to join, and I will show you the join and then what to do from that point. After working that perimeter round, we're going to just join with a slip stitch to the first stitch, slip stitch of the round. Do not fasten off. We're going to turn, and now we're going to work rows 1 through 12 of the woven stitch. We start with a chain 2, and starting in the next stitch, I'm going to demonstrate quickly how to do the woven stitch. If you need additional stitch support that is more detailed, please check the video description below. I will have a link for the woven stitch in the list of the other stitch videos. Okay, so for this stitch, we're going to wrap our hook, pull up a loop, pull through one loop, yarn over, pull through two, that's halfway, then yarn over, insert, pull up a loop, and pull through two loops on the hook, and that is a woven stitch. As we're working across the foundational row into the single crochets, we're going to work in every other stitch. Okay, so we wrap the hook, skip that stitch, pull up a loop, pull through one, yarn over, pull through two, and then yarn over, pull up a loop, and pull through two loops on the hook. Skip the next stitch. And we're just going to do that all the way across. Yarn over, pull up a loop, pull through, yarn over, pull through two, yarn over, pull up a loop, and then pull through two. You do not wrap, just if you've noticed, you don't wrap the hook the last time. Let's do that one more time. Yarn over, we're going to skip this stitch, pull up a loop, pull through one, yarn over, pull through two, yarn over, pull up a loop, and then pull through two. Now we're going to work this all the way across. If you have 124 stitches, you should have 62 stitches, 62 woven stitches as you go across. Now I'm going to just show you what's going to happen. At the end of the row, you're going to chain two, and I'm just going to show you just quickly how to work in the other rows. Of course, you're going to work all the way across the row. I'm just doing a quick demo here. So when you start the next row, we're going to chain two, turn, and we're going to work in between the woven stitches. See, the space in between the stitches is where we're going to work, just like this. Okay, and so go ahead and do that. Go ahead and work 12 rows of the woven stitch on this end, and when you complete that, you're going to join with a slip stitch in the chain one space on the other end of the afghan and work 12 rows of woven stitch across, and then fasten off when you're finished. Now I want to show you how to make those beautiful tassels that go on the four corners. You're going to need a book that's approximately 9 to 9.5 inches in length that we're going to wrap around, and you're going to need a fairly sharp pair of scissors as well as a needle, a little yarn needle. Okay, so we're going to start by taking our yarn. And lengthwise, like about, like I said, 9 to 9.5 inches in length, we're going to wrap the yarn around our book, or you can even use a piece of cardboard to cut to about 9.5 inches. So go ahead and do that 60 times, wrapping the yarn 60 times around. After wrapping my yarn around 60 times, it looks about like this. And I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to trim that strand just like that. Now, I went ahead, I'm going to set this aside, and I cut two other strands, one approximately 12 inches and one about 10 inches. Okay, so I'm going to take the one that's 12 inches and keep it ready right here. Now, before I cut this off of the book, I'm going to take this 12-inch strand and I'm going to run it underneath one side of all this yarn before I cut it. Okay, so I'm going to run it underneath here. Notice that I'm going to pull it to the opposite direction of where the yarn was trimmed on this end. After bringing this strand underneath, we're going to try to tie this as tightly as we possibly can without breaking the string, of course. So I'm going to tie it very tightly there, and I'm going to bring it around again. Now this does tend to loosen up on you, so let's tie it very, very tightly and turn. And then do it again. You almost need three hands to do this. There we go. I was able to get that pretty tight right there at the top. Now we're going to take our fairly sharp scissors and we're going to trim the strands along the bottom. Okay. And then we end up with something that looks like this. Okay, and it's actually fairly even on the bottom there. So now we need to tie another strand around the top right here, and we're going to take our other string just like this, and approximately an inch below, we're going to wrap this around a couple times. 1, 2, 3. And I'm going to tie a knot here. Okay, I just tied that once, and I'm going to come around the back side and do that again. And then I'm actually going to give it a little bit of a knot. And I'll show you how to hide this in just a second. Having trouble with my fingers this morning. There we go. And so after we do that, we want to try to hide this knot inside. So what we're going to do is we're going to thread these threads into our yarn needle. There we go. Make sure we get all of the threads in there. I know I probably should have left a little more yarn here, but we're going to work with this even though it's short. And then what you can do is even take the head of the needle and go into the center, just like this, and push it in. And as you can see, that knot very quickly disappears. Let's go ahead and pull that out. We can pull the strand out of the needle. There we go. Pulled it down into the mix there. Okay, so the knot is hidden on our little tassel. And let me give you one other thing that you can do. If you find that the yarn is just too wavy and you would like the yarn to be straighter, all you need to do is take a steamer. And you can just steam all of the yarn and then it will come right out. and you know, it would be nice and straight for you. I think this is straight enough as is. And so now the only thing I need to do now is, if I want to trim this up a bit, let me go ahead and try it from the other end here. Actually, that's pretty good. I'm just going to trim it a little tiny bit on the edge here. And I think this tassel is good to go. So I have one tassel ready. All I need to do now is make three more, and then we're just going to attach it to the corner by tying it with these strings. Now we just have a little bit of unfinished business, and that is of hiding these loose strands. And let me show you why you left 4 to 5 inches at least on these strands. We're going to thread these. And yeah, I actually do two at a time where I have the knotted balls of yarn. I don't know if that violates anybody's conscience or not, but I have not had a problem doing this. And then we simply run this under the stitches. Now notice that I have the back side of the throw facing. So I'm just going to run these under just like this. This makes it go by really quickly and easily. And then gently pull this through and bring that out. Okay, and then pull back a little bit on these stitches just so that there, that it fits in. And then very carefully, notice I'm cutting near the stitch, but I am not cutting the stitch, and give that a clip. And that yarn is very well hidden on the back side where nobody is going to notice. So you probably have a bunch more of those to do, so go ahead and do that now. Once you've gone ahead and done that, the only thing left to do is to attach our tassels to the corners. And what you can do is find what is the corner of each corner of the throw. And that sounds redundant. And we're just going to bring our strands, just one strand like this. And we're just going to tie these tightly. I'm going to do a simple square knot as I tie it on. Now, of course, we have these strands that we're going to want to hide. And you can either hide them one at a time. Let's try that. Let's do one at a time on these corners just so there's no extra bulk where it can be seen. Okay, so let's go ahead and turn to the back side, and we're going to just run each of these strands down into the stitches so they can be well hidden. And if we use a single strand, I believe that that is going to be hidden very well. And let's go ahead and I like to also go different directions sometimes. That way there's a little bit of resistance on pullback with these stitches. So let's go ahead and run it back here just a little bit. Kind of like in a little bit of a circle, but not a tight circle. Okay, and I think that is pretty good. And so we're going to just go ahead and give this a clip. Again, close, but not too close so that you hurt the stitch in any way, shape, or form. And let's go ahead and do the second strand as well. It's a little bit of a tedious thing to do, but it's something that once it's done, it just really gives the project a wonderful finished look. And if you do this in the right way, then none of the strands are going to ever come out again. And you know, if, especially if you're going to be, you know, giving this as a gift, and you know, they're probably going to be putting it through a washer machine if you've, you know, if you've used an acrylic or an acrylic, even the acrylic alpaca blend, I believe, just check the yarn label, but it is pretty much washable, which makes it very useful in a family room. Okay, so let's go ahead and I'm going to run this one a little bit in a circle as well. Let's come back up with this. I'm just doing this over the woven stitches. You don't have to do this in this way with the strands that are on the back side of the afghan. This is just one that may actually show a bit more since it's part of the border. And then I'm going to just trim this there. And I think that's going to be well hidden. Whoops. Knocking my light box over. Okay, so that pom-pom is securely attached to the corner and should be there for a long, long time. All right. let's show you what we have.
I hope you enjoyed making the Celtic cabled Afghan with me today. Please check out some of the offerings on my channel, and please hit that thumbs up if you like the project, and don't forget to hit subscribe. God bless. Bye-bye.